morning. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is Babel. Joining me today is Arctic Shadow. So happy to have you back here. How are you feeling, man?
I'm feeling good, man. Feeling good. Just, yeah, eyes not feeling too good, but that's about it. I have to wear an eye patch for now. But yeah, how about yourself, man?
Didn't know you had a new black heart, but... But right, so in case you guys are wondering, that's an image of my co-caster Arctic Shadow. He's having a bit of an eye problem, so he's resting up and not going to be nice to show you guys his really cool eye patch. But yeah, so we're both sick. He cannot see and I cannot talk because I'm having a little bit of a cough here. So do give us the understanding this is a pretty injured casting crew you're looking at today. All right, so four teams in the Thailand National Finals. The format's a little bit different, which is why it's four teams. We got with us here a double elimination best of three bracket. Only two out of these four teams will advance on. We're actually going to go and show you the bracket so everyone has a very clear understanding of the standings today. And there we have the brackets. Winner's bracket. Everyone's going to start right here. Four teams, play 10, lose 11. 4 week of love. Greedy is good, 9999, and Hothead Gaming. I love Greedy is good so much. I am actually going to root for them because that name is so good. Don't you agree?
Yep, I definitely do agree with you there.
So which is your favorite team name?
I have to say 4 weeks of love.
Oh, okay. It's 4 week though, not 4 weeks.
True, true.
All right, that's fine. So we got our allegiance settled already. Just 30 seconds into this cast. I like that so much. A bit of history for Play 10. Play 10 is not the same lineup as per the 2015 Thailand representative. They have already changed up quite a fair bit. Oh, actually, the bracket is going to switch around. 4 week of love. It's going up against Greed is good.
Oh, okay.
Hothead's going to play against Play 10. But by the way, as I was saying, Play 10 is the official Thailand representative in the 2015 Road to BlizzCon circuit. Here, they have actually broken up into a couple of teams. So it's a completely different roster. You guys who used to root for Play 10, please continue rooting for them. Now, I do believe it is just one guy that from the same old roster. One or two. The rest of the other three just broke up into a few couple other teams. All right, so this is how it's going to work. All four teams have actually been guaranteed prize pool. And top two is going to get a lot more money, as well as the first and second seed out of Thailand. And they will join up with representatives from Singapore, Resurgence, Relics, representatives from Malaysia. That's Arctic Shadow's hometown right there. FFKG, Fong Fei K Gaming, as well as Prospector Malaysia. And just fresh off the oven yesterday, joining in from Philippines, Renovasho 1 and Renovasho 2. Great. We have a game. The draft is actually starting already. The first series is going to be between Play 10 and Hothead Gaming. I'm going to say I have a lot of history here with Play 10. As in, I've casted these guys a lot. They are very, very warrior-centric. But then again, it's a different roster here. So what do you make of this draft? Towers of Doom, by the way.
Yeah, Towers of Doom. One of the maps, one of my favorite maps right now as well. I believe it's one of yours as well.
But, my favorite.
Yeah, but probably for different reasons, you know. But, yeah, Towers
of
Doom.
What's your reason?
I like the fact that it's not a push-centric kind of lineup. You know, it's not something where you can just end the game just like that, where you can end it in 10 minutes. Of course you can, but it takes a lot more time. And teams have a lot more chances to come back from this in this map.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Did you see that?
Artanis being picked up here. So man, taking a look at the bans and the pickup so far, over in Play 10, lose 11, we see the bans being Sonya and ETC, and picking up Rhaegar, Tassadar, and Illidan. And as you mentioned, though, they are warrior-centric, but they actually banned out two warriors and two bruises here and going with the Rhaegar, Tassadar, and Illidan instead. Heroes that I personally haven't seen yet is Tassadar and Illidan in any of my competitive games. So that's interesting for me.
Oh, you've actually seen Artanis before.
Yes, in the Malaysian qualifier. I believe they did.
Okay, so this is going to be the run-up here. Realize that there is no Abathur. That's because Hothead Gaming just wants a clean game, and Abathur does a lot of split-push action. It's kind of like the Vikings idea, and Towers of Doom is slowly evolving to become a specialist-centric map with Lost Vikings and Abathur as a huge advantage. Speaking about that, Vikings is still not banned yet, so it could be possible to see a Vikings getting picked up here. Play 10 with Illidan, Tassadar. Looks like it's going to be a Protect the Illidan comp, a very teamfight-centric composition out of Play 10, but it depends on whether they really want to pick up Vikings for Split Soak, and there's not much teamfights, really. You have split objectives, you can split alters, so this is where it's going to be important for Play 10 to decide what is the main strategy. For Hothead, though, it's my first time casting Artanis. My feedback on Artanis is that it's very close to being viable, But so far, the only reason why it's not is because it's very late game centric. He only does a lot of work and damage level 16 and 20. Before that, he doesn't do as much. Yesterday, we saw some Chen getting picked up, and the whole chat was like, Chen is unique meta, right? Today, we are seeing Chen getting picked up in the NA regional. So we are not really too far off, boys. That's all I have to say.
I don't think they were actually looking for the meta. It was more of experimenting, as you mentioned, the Filipinos. They are a very different esports country. Even back in all the other types of MOBAs, they're always the types that, ooh.
Wow. Okay, Rexxar. So this is... Rexxar is good. I've actually seen some Rexxar games on Towers of Doom. Pretty okay. Normally, you park that Rexxar top lane because he's going to be able to push and apply a lot of pressure there as well. Plus, again, pick up those mercenary camps on top by himself. The problem here is that Towers of Doom is a pretty small map. It's good news that there's no Thuranda. So there's yet. So at least you don't see that Thuranda, Muradin, stun comp, rotation-centric ganks coming out. But I'm thinking Hot Hit maybe considering that one. Oh, actually going to be Sylvanas, which is even better. I really like Hot Hit's lineup.
This is interesting, though. This is the first time that I've seen a team without a support hero.
Well, it could be a timeout there. I don't know exactly, because we saw that the timer go down to 0-0-0. Mm-hmm. For Zagara, Sylvanas, if it's a Sylvanas and if it's intended, I like this a lot, because Sylvanas, Zagara pushes very, very far.
Yep.
It's only tricky because you really need a support to keep that front line alive, and that's Artanis Muradin up against a dual support meta. I think Hothead's actually in a lot of trouble. I like the fact they've got some push, but I don't like the fact that you pointed out nicely, no support.
Yep. It's going to be tough for them in those team clashes, I think, because Artanis and Muradin's not going to have anyone to support them up. And even in terms of damage as well, they don't have a huge amount of damage coming up from the team. When you look at Play 10, Lucy 11, they do have the Illidan and Tychus, along with the Rexxar as well as the body in front to bruise the team away. But over in Hothead Gaming, this is going to be interesting. It does look like a push-centric lineup here. Zagara and Sylvanas will be probably pushing the lanes as fast as they can. Are they going to try and collect all three lanes and just try to slowly pull them down?
Okay, this is the tricky thing about House of Doom. If you have a Sylvanas, normally you win a team fight, she can push down the lane very well, mm-hmm. and you have a very good control. I've seen some of the Singaporean teams did that before with Sylvanas going in, specifically Relix actually. They like to take down the fort the moment they win a fight, and with Sylvanas that's a lot easier. Zagara is good, but Zagara is kind of like solo lane push, which is like the secondary option the moment you don't have Sylvanas to pick for. Sylvanas is the best pick, in my opinion, for Towers of Doom. Zagara, however, provides vision, so she's able to stay alive a little bit better in the early game, and you know she can just do work on her own lane. That's the main strategy here. But for Hot Hit, my concern is I don't think they win a team fight because they have zero sustain.
Yep.
Absolutely zero sustain. Artanis is late game, like I mentioned before. Lunara probably can chip away, but you're fighting against an Illidan, and he's going to be in the back line.
Yep.
It's not easy. Would say that although I like the creativity, if you will, from Hot Hit Gaming, I think that Play 10 actually should win this game.
Yeah, Play 10 definitely wins this draw for me as well. With the dual support and Rexxar in front, Illidan going to be able to dive into the back lines with the support of Tassadar as well. I don't think Lunara is going to be able to survive for very long, in fact. And if Artanis and Muradin can't protect their team, I don't think Hot Hit Gaming has a chance here, unless they prove us wrong with some sort of push-centric comp to try and throw Play 10 Lucy 11 off guard. But it is going to be really, really tough for them, I believe. And my money is all going to be on Play 10 Lucy 11 here in this game too.
Right, and I'm excited as Artanis. I'm just a little bit sad that there's no support. It actually could be the fact that Sylvanas is not the right pick, and that they're waiting for the admins to allow them to change it up because you know just couldn't lock it in time. Just for everybody to know that right now, we're using heroesdraft.com, which actually allows shadow picking. And when the time actually reaches the limit, your shadow picked hero will be the lock in. Will be the hero that's gonna get locked in. And mm-hmm. Don't worry, because the shadow pick does not get revealed to the enemy unless they have like your draft link or something like that. I'm not sure how that works, but shouldn't be the case. All the ops link, and that's the main reason why some teams don't like shadow picking. It actually shows what you're thinking.
Yeah, all just right. The honor system.
Yeah, well, integrity, man. Esports needs more of that.
Yep, definitely have to agree with you. Yeah, it is going to be a really interesting game for me. I was expecting a Tyrande, as you mentioned, Tyrande pick up for Hothead Gaming as the last pick, but instead they went with the Sylvanas. Hopefully they're going to be able to make it work, or if, as you mentioned, it is just a mistake, hopefully the admins will allow them to switch that pick over to Sylvanas, and the Sylvanas Muradin combo will help them out quite a bit here with that support. Even though it's not the best healer, I think they have a much better lineup if they have the Tyrande.
Okay. So it seems like there was an issue just now with the draft. We are actually going into the new draft link. It looks almost the same, though.
Oh, okay.
Just at the last few, I think there was a bit of a connection issue, which is why they couldn't pick the last few heroes. But there we go. We are finally back to the real... I don't know. This is like 3 minutes ago, Arctic Shadow.
Mm-hmm,
but
mm-hmm.
It looks about the same. We still see the Zagara. The only difference here is that there's no Artanis. So Artanis may not be the intended one. This is the old one with Tychus, Rexxar, Sylvanas, and Artanis. We are loading into the new one when the producers got that fixed. Yep. Yeah, here we go. All right. So no Artanis. Okay. This makes a lot more sense. Like, I thought that we are actually going to have a great game, man.
I was expecting it too, but yeah, that's why when I saw the Rexxar, it was a bit, bit weird for me as well. But yeah, we do see the Troll instead of the Artanis going to be picked up, and that makes so much more sense here.
Yeah, well, I thought we were going to see the Protoss brothers take a stab at each other, but it's going to be Tesdar, Illidan, Rengar. So still protect the Illidan comp out of play 10. And this is exactly straight out of the movie Time Traveler, where you get to right or wrong in your life, and that's the pick, man, the Thrall.
Yeah, I do have to agree with you. As now we see the shadow pick of Johanna coming up from play 10, lose 11. That is probably going to be the front line. Previously, they picked up the Rexxar, yeah, so it's not going to be actually the Rexxar here. If they do go with the Johanna, what do you think would be a good last pick here for play 10, lose 11?
Okay, Johanna with Illidan there's just not much synergy. The main reason why they're picking Johanna here is because she's got Shield Glare.
Yep.
And they don't want to allow the Shield Glare through. The problem with Hothead is that I'm not so sure if they are still interested in the support, but they should be.
Mm.
For play 10, though, Johanna, Illidan, at least you provide some form of control in front with Illidan. Johanna's a very sticky hero, so when Illidan makes the jump, Johanna's going to be in front. Plus, the fact that with Iron Skin, your support can really support Illidan a lot better. Leaming is good for a far-range damage dealer. She's really awesome. Definitely, you can look to Illidan to finish up the job. I don't think Leaming should be able to do it because it's very tricky to get the Arcane up to connect. That's the difficult part.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it is going to be quite interesting here. They have quite a bit of damage coming out from Leaming and Illidan, and if Tassadar and Rhaegar can keep them alive. Johanna, though, not my favorite bruiser. He doesn't have a lot of damage, doesn't really do much for me, and as you mentioned, Johanna and Illidan, there's just no chemistry going on between the two of them. Though I do think maybe that Johanna's pickup is also because the fact that there's no mages on Hothead Gaming, so the blind might come into play quite a bit here. So that is going to be quite interesting. And Hothead Gaming pick up the Lieutenant Morales as a final pick. Again, Tyrande not banned out, but not picked up here.
Yeah, I'm just glad that there is a support on that side.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be honest with you. I was really just afraid that there was no support. Okay, so the thing here about Johanna is that she, like you pointed out very nicely, she's a great counter against Thrall, Zagara. Do note that the Shield Glare also affects Zagara's minions as well, so that's why it's a good pick. The other problem here is that Morales is going to be the key hero, and you know for sure that Illidan's going to jump on Morales. They have to take her down.
Yep.
So it's going to be up to Leaming to create a space for that instant burst in the first few seconds of the fight before Illidan goes in to commit. However, the win condition for Hothead Gaming is actually going to be very, very easy. The moment Illidan overextends, you're going to want to have the maximum damage behind. There is the Devouring Maw for a Croc Control. So I like that a lot. Sundering as well in the back line. So you have like that 1 to 2 seconds which you can look for a burst against Illidan. It's going to be tricky because he does have evasion. So if Thrall uses Wind Fury in the right moment, it's going to be a kill. However, if he uses Wind Fury into evasion, that's not going to be pretty.
Mm-hmm. It's also really, really fun to see that all the different countries in the Southeast Asian region, you know, has such different draft type centric kind of compositions. Like, I think the closest that I've seen so far is Malaysia and Singapore. They're very close in terms of draft. Correct me if I'm wrong, of course, but it's weird how when we casted the Malaysia, we saw almost Diablo every single game. But then when we go to the Philippines and to Thailand, we didn't see much of the Diablo coming out. So it's interesting to see how different, you know, all the play styles coming from each country is. And this is just going to make the C regionals all the more interesting. You know, teams are going to have to do a lot more research on the other teams as well.
Agree. Absolutely agree. The tricky part here about the SEA regional is that we're finally going to see who is actually correct. Because everyone has got their own like understanding of the current meta, their own interpretation. Would say that so far, it looks like two support is still pretty much relevant here. And I really like the fact that they got their Tesla Rhaegar on play 10. It's a dream combo, really. Nobody's going to die there. It's not easy at all. There's also a bit of a lack of burst on the side of Hot Hit Gaming. Thrall can go in, but you know Shuglash is an instant counter, so there's not much damage if the timing's off for Hothead. It's going to be tricky.
Yep, it's definitely going to be an interesting game here. It makes a game that makes much more sense compared to the previous draft. Though I would have liked to see the Artanis as well as the Rexxar.
Oh, yeah, man, that's the dream. I mean, Artanis and Rexxar in Tops of Doom, I actually like the idea of having Rexxar here. He's just not as viable right now because there's not much of a split push. Rexxar really likes to have like split soak, that kind of mechanic in play. Mm-hmm. House of Doom, it's almost guaranteed you really have to go for the objective mm-hmm. because that does damage to the core and there's no other way, which is why Rexxar may not necessarily be a good idea. He can work if you have a four-centric core comp, the four core with Rexxar just split push top and you get an extra fort, but the extra fort doesn't do anything unless you can win the altar fights. That's the problem.
Yep, definitely have to agree with you here. So you were telling me earlier as well that there's a lot of rivalry going on between the Thai teams and are they actually not on like good terms or something?
You know, it's just like how Malaysia ended up after the events of 2015's Road to BlizzCon. A lot of teams broke up except for one team. Mm-hmm. And then after the Nexus Championship, all the teams broke up. So Thailand just had that a lot earlier than Malaysia. So after the Road to BlizzCon, every single team in Thailand more or less broke up. It's like a big awakening.
Reshuffle.
It's like international, or rather national team disbanding.
Okay.
So that's what happened to Thailand, I think about 3 to 4 months earlier than Malaysia. The good news is that they've been given a little bit more time to sort out their roster. Mm-hmm. The bad news is that I don't think that their roster is fixed until like 2 to 3 weeks before the qualifiers for this national. Mm-hmm. I really have to see who's in which team to be able to tell you more though. And because I don't have the roster list with me, for the Malaysian scene, I think they actually have another team called Sugar Gaming or something.
Yep.
After Salt Gaming. And that is actually a very good team, but they were not able to compete because of various roster reasons at the end,
yep,
right?
Correct.
Yeah, that's the sad part.
Yeah, there was some drama that happened behind that. I'm not going to get in too deep into it here, but yeah, just some roster problems between the teammates. I think they had some issues with each other, they weren't able to make it. They couldn't agree, and so they're just like fighting amongst each other, and there's like, you know what, we're just gonna play it. And it was actually Sugar Gaming that took down FFKG in the qualifier as well. So yeah, you know, considering FFKG came out champions, who knows if Sugar Gaming was playing it, it would have been a different ball game altogether.
Yeah, would have been, definitely. I would agree as well. Relix also had a bit of a problem with that in the department in Singapore. They also just had a roster swap 1 week before the tournament, but they still managed to qualify. Our format in Singapore is a little bit different. We had a pro league actually, and Resurgence, the best team in SG, because they came out of the pro league, the champions, they're being set aside. Now in Thailand, Play 10 Lose 11 is a pretty well known name. They got a really interesting series of success on the way from the Road to BlizzCon 2015. They basically are the most dominating team in Thailand for majority of 2015 until after the nationals. That's where everything just went, you know, loose, and people just start changing teams as and when they like.
Yeah, I think it's pretty common, you know, reshuffles and, you know, internal conflicts and stuff. But it's definitely something that the esports scene as a whole lacks. It's some sort of a governing body to keep from all this happening, you know, because like if you look at football, as much as, you know, some players might hate each other, but they still have to work together somehow to get the job done. I think that's just something that we haven't seen yet. Hopefully with esports growing so huge around the world, we will be seeing that soon. I definitely have to agree with you there.
Yeah, I would love to have that as well. All right, so Towers of Doom, For all of you guys who don't know this background, we actually have a very cute graphic that I think my producers are very keen to pull up about this background, the Towers of Doom, so that we can show you this cool new small little thing we prepared for you. It's not a video. I know that in China, you've got a video for almost every new map, but here we go. Towers of Doom, in case you haven't played this background yet, here we have it. This is the breakdown, man. You just have to go and protect the cores, activate the altars, claim the bell towers. There's three ways you can actually deal damage to the enemy core. The first way is by taking the altars, which is the battleground objective. The second way is by going to the Headless Horseman, aka the boss, in this map. He does 4 damage to core when you claim it. The third way is to escort those small little pumpkin heads, as I call them, to the border. The boundary, the no man's land, and they automatically launch themselves as damage to the enemy core. So that does 3 damage, or 1 per pumpkin head. And basically, this battleground allows no pushing. And so far, you look at the lineup from the draft just now, it looks like they have a very, very different understanding of this battleground. You have on one side Zagar that's probably going to be able to claim a lot of bell towers. Mm-hmm. And on the other side, you've also got a pretty teamfight sentry comp, I would say.
Yeah, I think Play 10 to Lose are going to go for the altars here. And like I said, Hothead Gaming, just as the previous round when they had the, I believe it was the Sylvanas, when they, the wrong draft, you know, they're going for the a little bit more push-centric. They want to maybe claim more bell towers, apply more pressures. Because of course, when you lose your bell towers, the amount of damage you do to the core when you claim those altars, it's negated as well because, you know, you do less damage. So if they're able to keep control of one bell tower at all time, Play 10 to Lose, lose 11, no matter how many altars you claim, you're just going to be doing less damage each time a bell tower drops as well. So it's going to be really interesting to see between the two lineups here. I don't think Hothead Gaming will try to take them hit on as much because Play 10 to Lose 11 definitely has a lot more a lot more chemistry in their team when it comes to those team fights. And I think it's going to be hard for Hothead Gaming to actually, you know, fight at those altars. So they're going to have to find a way to go around it. Maybe they're going to try and push in a little bit more with those pumpkin hits, as you mentioned. So yeah, it's going to be interesting. You know, it is Thailand. They are, I think even back from when I used to cast Heroes of New Earth back then, Thailand was always the wild card, you know, when they first joined into the competition. It's a team, it's a country where they're willing to try new things. They don't actually follow the meta. I'm not too sure if that's the same for Hots here, but yeah, that's how it is around the world, I would say, with Thailand. So it's definitely going to be interesting to watch the Thai teams play here.
Agree. The Thai teams, they are definitely a little bit more experimental, but so far my history with Thailand has been a little bit emotional. I mean, they have a lot of weird heroes that I like Arthas, and I thought that it's pretty interesting. 2015, before the entire global championship happened, Thailand's the team that really focused on Arthas, and the main reason why they picked out Arthas, I actually had the chance to ask them in the offline interview back then, and they clarified that it's because Arthas does AoE damage. You know, and that's a very interesting take. Nobody actually really prioritizes AoE damage from a warrior except for Thailand. So they have a very different set of consideration. And just looking at some of these familiar names, I can tell you that it's interesting that it's Coupe, Lion-X, and Kitcharak that's going to actually continue playing on Play 10. They no longer have no CSM and Lauda actually. Lauda and no CSM basically change teams. So here, Hothead Gaming still waiting for their lineup to come in. TNK actually gonna also be playing for Hothead Gaming. So I actually know TNK for a while, and he's a great player. So this will be a close match.
Yep, definitely looking forward to more action coming out from the Thailand team. I was quite sad that I wasn't able to cast the Philippine games due to the huge delay that we had yesterday, you know, and had to leave you to solo cast for the entire day. But yeah,
it's okay. I will have my chance one day.
Your chance to throw it right back at me, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but I was able to catch a few games, and as you mentioned, there was quite a few pickup on Chen's as well, and ultimately Renovation 1 and 2 both picking up the number 1 and 2 spots respectively. Yeah, it's really going to be an interesting finals next week. I'm really looking forward to the C finals, and I have to give good news that FFKG, I believe, will be playing in the C regional finals as well. So
awesome.
Yeah, so hopefully
maybe we can get top 4 right now. Maybe top 4.
Yeah. if you're I think Mofalicious is in chat as well, so, and, you know, shout out to Mofalicious, you know, buck up a little bit, you know, take down, cause some upsets. That's what I want to see.
Yeah, he's rooting for Malaysia. I mean, we're not biased.
Yep.
He's rooting for Malaysia. I'm rooting for Singapore. Philippines and Thailand do not have their representative in this cast. I'm so sorry, but maybe one day we will have them. So I'm actually looking at this lineup, and I'm very excited already. A-Leagues, by the way, is going to be playing for Hothead Gaming. That's a lady. She's playing. She's one of the more accomplished Thai players around.
Is she really a lady? I don't think she is.
She's really. I think she really is, yeah.
Elise, right? A-L-Y-S-E. Yeah. I played with her a couple of times before. I think she's quite close to the Malaysian scene as well. So I've seen her in quite a few pub games. But are you sure it's a girl? I think it's a guy.
I don't know. My information tells me it's a girl. So.
Okay.
Well, I have to fly down and I have to check that out. You can join me in Thailand, but because it's Thailand, I think, you know, you may be, there's always that 50% of surprise where you get disappointed or genuinely happy. We don't know, man. We don't know.
Yeah, but I have played with her quite a bit as well. Him, her. We're not too sure who she is right now yet.
It's a lady because I have Kicharak on my friend list and he's just spamming on a broadcast TNK and Grill. So. Yeah, I actually think it is a lady, but we'll have to see those photographs. And even then, they are like, you know, not convincing because it's Thailand, right? So they have a long history of confusion. So I'm just saying. I'm excited for this game. I really am. Regardless whether it's a guy or lady, I don't think it matters because it's good. It's awesome to have Ailis in this game. She's she or he, mind you. That's a really good player.
Yep.
Yeah. So, by the way, we have a new system. Just type !! Vote Hothead Gaming or !! Vote Play 10 Lose 11. Do note that the team names is one word. Hothead Gaming and Play 10 Lose 11 on Twitch. Actually, no, I'm getting an update again. There is actually spacing. I don't know why you're doing that. If it's possible, make it the one word or abbreviation so it's a lot easier. But for now, it's actually !! Vote Hot space hit space gaming. Look how hard it is for me, Zenden. Please make my life easy. Sorry, vote Play 10 Lose 11. He just threw a marker in my face on Twitch. And yeah, we're a very tight broadcasting crew, very small, very bonded. Hope you guys enjoy this cast. We are ready to go in the game. And Arctic Shadow, please let me know who you're supporting. Don't change your support because Ailis could be a girl.
No, I'm still going with Play 10 to Lose 11 here because I think their lineup is a little bit more teamfight centric, and that's the main reason why I love Heroes of the Storm is because it's all about teamfight, it's all about execution, and that's what I love about the game. So definitely looking forward to how they pull this out. But of course, Hothead Gaming, without a doubt, you know, going with a different strategy. It's all about strategy as well. If your opponents are going one way, if you can surprise them by going another with your strategy, and it works out, that's also something that I look forward to. So hopefully Hothead Gaming will be able to give a surprise here in this game, but my money is still on Play 10 Lose 11, just like the previous draft as well. So hopefully we'll see lots of team fights, lots of action coming out from both teams. I'm just really excited to go into this game. And yeah, guys, do, you know, vote for the teams that you think is going to win. I myself am going to do this here. Let me vote for Play 10 Lose 11.
Okay, so do let us know in chat if there's any issue at all with the stream. We got our producers looking out keenly. They are looking at the chat as and when. Let us know if there's any sound audio issues or if there's any lag latency problem. And it's going to be up to Zenden to fix it. Meanwhile, Towers of Doom, we are getting ready to get into this game. And number one, do note that the format is a little bit different. Best of three double elimination both ways. So the low bracket's also best of three for Thailand. There's a reason why they only got four teams. And we're actually expecting to enter this broadcast on time at 7:30 p.m. It's a 12:10 though, so I think we are actually behind schedule,
yep,
as usual. Nothing surprising. This is SEA.
I would say it's more of any region, in fact. I think there's always going to be delays, especially when it's a LAN event. I think that's the main thing. If it's an online event, you know, things can be smoothened out a little bit more because teams have more time, more prep time. You don't have to switch your keyboards and stuff. But yeah, since it is going to be a LAN event, it will have some delays here and there, especially with the cafes where they're at, if they're having some internet issues. But it does look like we're going to be getting into the game. So people run us through the lineups because it's still loading for me.
Okay, no problem. On the blue team, it's going to be Hothead Gaming. We've got Yamato playing as Thrall, Freedom onto the Morales TNK. We'll be playing as the Muradin Ailes onto the Lunara Las Benales. Andrew Baby as the Zagara on the red team. Play 10, Loose 11, Porsche. That's the car I like. And it's going to be the Johanna Lionex onto the Illidan Kicharak as Rhaegar Coupe. Gonna be playing as the Leeming. Last but not least, we do have.
Can't see anything right now, so for the meantime, I have to do what I did to you yesterday, and you're on your own.
No problem. I'm actually gonna have to cover this until we fix this this little bit of a lag problem that the stream's facing. In the meantime, though, gonna take this solo for a bit. So far, you're looking at the here splitting sites already. A bit of a fight happening in the mid area. Porsche is going to be here as well. TNK in a party bush, not probably looking for a gang. There's not much of support in the area. Bottom lane, you have a solo Zagara there, so she is already spreading the creeped humor, which is important for vision, and I like that a lot. The tricky part here is that you really need to have a couple of stuns going out, actually, and then we have the bomb from the arcane up. But you really need to have a good rotation. And so far, both teams are struggling to have it going. Top lane, Thrall versus Illidan. That's going to be pretty boring. So they're not going to be able to kill each other early on. Lunara in the mid lane area with Porsche there as well. So far, don't think we're actually going to get much action in the early game. But if you look at the talent build-up so far, it looks to be pretty okay. We got a Reverberation build, a standard Thunderclap from the Muradin. Zagara with the... Reconstitution, also going to see this natural perspective. This is a very different pickup for Lunara. Normally go for Cruis Spores, but this one here is good to have as well because that gives you a bit of extra vision. Meanwhile, Thrall for full-fledged damage. No right the lightning, rolling thunder kind of a thing. Probably going to be the right the lightning though. We still don't know what's the pickup there. SG has a very different pick at level 4. We do have Ultimoras going for Safeguard, so that's pretty okay. Meanwhile, TNK taking a bit of a damage, already pulling back out. And the first set of ults is going to be splitting sites, one to the left and one to the right. Monogatari trying to cancel this one out. The Signing Storm, it is going to connect at the end. And also, you will see that Johanna going to play. A nice soft toss. TNK is just fine. Ailes in a little bit of trouble, going to be very safe. But we see Thrall missing the Feral Spirit. You're going to have to pull back out Yamato, that is. And all five members are right here. Zagara swings by, trying to cancel this one out. Nice chain lightning going back out. It will have to be right the lightning, but nope, it's actually the Envenom. And already you could see that Johanna taking a lot of damage. A fight still going on. Yamato taking a lot of damage. Coupe having to pull back out. Tassadar popping the dimension shift. Illidan whooping the first blood of the game here. Ende, Monogatari now getting stunned back up. Nice chain heal, but is it enough? Nope, the extra shield also not enough. Tassadar will take the 4. Two men down on a set of play 10, and Hothead Gaming having a bit of a lead from their fight. They finally secured their own altar. It's a bit of overextension and greed on the part of a play 10, but it's a good play at the end. They were banking on the fact that Zagara is nowhere close at all. Zagara being at the bottom part of this battleground, and still, you don't see that kind of rotation coming in here. Okay, so we do have Freedom in the bottom lane here supporting Zagara. We do also see Rhaegar with a bit of rotation down to this bottom site. Top lane, there's been a bit of a change. It's going to be the Lunara up against Illidan, and I don't like this. Lunara's not as good to counter against Illidan. I kind of prefer Thrall. At least he's got that self-sustain going on. It doesn't matter if he's doing the damage against Illidan with Wind Fury or not. He just needs to heal back up. So talking about the Talon builds right here, for Morales is Trauma Trigger, which is actually very important. Advanced block. So Trauma Trigger allows her to apply another safeguard on herself. Advanced block is the one that keeps her alive. This is going to be important for Morales. She's looking to stay alive in this fight here where there is an Illidan. So this Talon build looks directly in favor of making that happen. Porsche in the mid lane should be fine, by the way. Alright, so we do have Ulta and Venom Spines, very standard build there. Nimba Wisp instead of a Timeless or Skybound. So this one is basically a bit of increased movement speed and vision radius. Some of the Lunara players really like to pick up the Dividing Whips as well. That provides a second one, or at least the Timeless one that gives you a bit of extra, you could say, mana management. So at least you will be able to provide some better sustained throughout the lanes. Piercing Bolt it is, very standard Muradin build, Endless Grip, standard Zagara as well. Splintered Spear is very different for me. I like Splintered Spear, but personally I'm thinking that while Vigor is a lot more important at level 7, because Lunara you want to do a lot more intensive single target burst damage. This one here allows you to do a lot more AoE. It's kind of like the AoE version, like the multi-shot build for Vala, but it has its pros and cons. And here you're up against 2 support, I kind of like burst a little bit better. Windshear, it's always good to have. This is the standard Wind Fury built for the Thrall without any sustain. No Frosthoof's Grace, nothing like that. And on this side here for Morales, it's going to be clear. Explosion, Radiant. So she's going to just really try to stay alive. We hear the Healer's Horseman coming in. The Altar spawning also in just a few seconds. Play 10 already securing this area. And meanwhile, Hot Hit Gaming nowhere in sight yet. They do have some extra time. Fantastic Feral Spirit by Yamato. Once again, they will be able to try and disjoin the channeling. TNK goes in. Fantastic Thunderclap. Reverberation also going to do some extra slow there against the right-click damage. But the majority of Play 10 has to pull back. And all of a sudden, you see that Hothead Gaming's gained a lot more of the ground support here. Kupe Sings by nice Arcane up. Not the maximum damage yet. In the meantime, Monogatari also having to put forth the psionic stomp, but no Ailey channeling at 50% already. Maybe looking at a first one. The Arcane up connects, and it's a beautiful cancellation there. Nice play by Coupe. The Thai teams are doing whatever they can, but I don't think it's going to be possible any longer, and it looks like Hothead Gaming is going to get this one. Illidan was not in a fight the whole time. He's just soaking the lane on top, and I think that play 10 was just dragging it out so that you have a lot more EXP with Illidan on top soaking up the lane. In a nutshell, so far, I'm really, really happy with what I'm seeing. There's a lot of very clutch execution maneuvers from both teams, canceling the tribute over and over again, showing once again that Thai teams, they're mechanically definitely superior. One of the better countries, in fact, with mechanics in this region of Southeast Asia. So far, Hothead Gaming's almost looking for the level 10. Play 10 loose 11 is at the level 9. They're still very, very close in terms of EXP, so I will not say that it's over or whatsoever. But at this instance here, it's going to be up to how a Lion-X soaks up the EXP on the top lane and if he can get an advantage for the team. Okay, now we're actually going to cover the talents on the red team. We do have Cleanse as well as a very standard, you could say, Lightning Shield build here. Stormcaller, Electric Charge, Lightning Shield is going to be pretty good as well. You have a reduced... You have increased radius as well as reduced mana cost, so that's going to help Rhaegar a little bit. Oh, the Pumpkin Heads is going to get activated. Two of them will connect. Meanwhile, standard Illidan with first aid as well as Immolation. And we will also have a standard, actually not a very standard Tassadar build. We do have the Leeching Plasma and Cause Embrace. And there's also information that we're going to restart the stream to solve the latency problem. But so far, you're going to have to deal with it for now. Hashtag deal with it. Blizzard Shield on that part. A magic missile build, but with Triumph V-Rate coming up from the Leeming. So Seeker it is going to be. I don't like the fact that there is no Eternal Retaliation. I'm still a big fan of that one here. Loss of Hope is probably the wiser option at the end. But I think that when you have Eternal Retaliation, you can actually do a lot more Condemn, which is important when you want to close the gap between the Illidan as well as Morales. It's important because your Johanna's not going to get affected by Displacement Grenade if she pops the end skin. So as long as she sticks onto Morales, she's in a lot of trouble. She's being forced to pull back, and that's important. Do note that it's also Steam Drone instead of Medivac, so Morales does not have an escape mechanic. And look at that distance, that pushback. Ailey's trying to channel that once again. The Disintegrate Beam going to go through. TNK buying a lot of time, but it's just going to go be a lot more damage to TNK. Monogatari also pulling back once again. You see a lot more damage onto that Testa. TNK going with the Steam Drone already. No stun on this Muradin, but a right-click damage still going to go through. It's not a Thrall time, but the stun does not connect. Bad timing right there, but it's going to be now. Porsche wall going down. Johanna's already gone. Lion-X pulling back, and Ailey's getting healed back up by Morales. And at the same time, Anju Baby pushing the lane a little bit. Hothead Gaming, they have absolute good control of that area there. All of a sudden, it's just tricky. What happened there? Definitely a great Devouring Maw won them that fight, and no use of Metamorphosis yet. Illidan was not going in, and that's the problem. They're slowly losing a lot of grounding here. 28 against 36. Lion-X going back up to the top lane of farm. Maybe because Play 10 knows that it's a late game for them. That's why they want to have that Illidan soak up the lane and just to get that EXP advantage until it's suitable for him to take the fight when he gets a lot more sustain. Either the 6th sense at level 13 or at level 16 having the Iron Skin or something of that sort. Oh no, sorry, Blood for Blood. I think that's good as well. Meanwhile, here for Hothead Gaming, they have the advantage right here. They have Thornwood Vine, they have Sundering, they got a lot of crowd control going to place. I like this Steam Drone Touch, but I kind of feel that it's a lot better when you use it on Thrall, given the fact that I've been schooled yesterday that that Muradin does not have any more stun in Avatar form. That's a little bit sad. Still important for him to pop the Avatar because he wants to make sure that you know, he does maximum damage. Oh man, a wasted pumpkin, but it's good. They will still be able to take down the tower. And so far, checking in on the structural situation here, most of the towers in the mid lane are actually still standing. They just traded the bottom set of towers for the top left set of towers. So still very even in that department, at least. Level 13 just hit here by Hothead Gaming. It's impressive how Playtan managed to keep this EXP so close. And they both will hit level 13 at the same time. It's going to be the Mutalist coming out for Zagara. Burning Rage onto the Muradin, and on the side for Thrall, it's going to be continuing the Wind Fury build with this Grace of Air. So twice as many stack, it's going to help him sustain a lot better. I like the fact that he will be able to do three more hits at level 16. And yes, Lunara finally going for Unfair Advantage. Very, very important talent here. Kind of looks like it's a bit of a split AoE as well as a single target damage oriented build, because normally you have Wall Vigor at level 7 and then you go in for Unfair Advantage at level 13. 16, looks like you should be going for a hold that thought. Actually going to see the Shield Glare coming up. Monogatari pulling back up. Porsche also. The fight going to happen here. And it looks like Andrew Baby's in a little bit of trouble already. Linex going to town. Disintegrate not going to be enough. Nice, Devarimor keeps that Zagara alive. As well as Porsche in the backline. But Linex still looking to create a little bit of havoc now. Locking onto the Morales, doing a lot more damage. Linex going in, and there goes the Metamorphosis. Is that going to be enough? Linex still knocking on the Morales. Morales is going to go down at the end. Ancestral healing will connect. And it connects beautifully onto that Illidan. We still see TNK given an extra chance here to pull back. Linex still going to town. They want to knock down onto that extra kill for the Muradin. Muradin will go down as well. They pick up that Alta. That's going to be a lot more damage. Lion-X will be able to solo and pick up this mercenary camp here. But that's a good fight because this is a 2 Alta phase for Playtan. Looks like it's very close. We got a core both sides. 28 HP. It's so, so good, this game. We got a replay. We're going to pull that one out. So what happened here in the last fight is very, very laggy for me. Okay, so what happened here is, if you see, this Devouring Maw kept Anju Baby alive, but there's already the damage done that they have to take this fight 4 versus 5 without the Zagara. And Illidan was going on to Morales. Without Zagara, Devouring Maw already used, they don't really have enough damage against the Illidan. And meanwhile, this entire time you have the backline Arcane up just doing a lot of work there against those heroes coming out of Hothead Gaming. And they don't have enough AoE burst damage. That's the problem when you go for a build like that for the Lunara. Not going to be enough damage to any single target. The tunnel just opened up here in this Towers of Doom. And it's important to note that this normally happens around the 12 minutes mark. And you baby taking a lot of damage from Disintegrate. Kicharak unfortunately not able to go in to take a bite of the Zagara HP. The juicy Zagara right there. Linex now knocking onto the mercenary camp. He is definitely going to look towards providing some pressure here. You want to take down this fort before the next Alta, and I think it's almost time. Monogatari taking a bit of damage from the Thornwood Vine. So Splintered Shot, will it work? Splintered Spear, will it work? That's the question. We see Linex going in. They really want to burst down this Morales. There's a little bit of safeguard on her, but it's not going to be enough. The Steam Drone nearly came out, but it got canceled at the end. What a fantastic pick of it is. You still see the Pumpkin Heads doing the work already. They want to push down the top fort. They can do it. They have 5 versus 3 only. Zagara's nowhere to be found. She's soaking in mid lane. Level 16 just got hit here by the red team. Full on Lightning Shield build with Earth Shield and Rising Storm. And also you see that for Illidan, it's going to be Stone Skin instead of a Blood for Blood. 6 cents, that's pretty okay as well. Johanna's going to go for that Imposing Presence, Spell Shield. So very, very tanky Johanna. And also very tanky Tassadar with Prescience as well as the Dimensional Warp here. Li Ming going for the full-on Magic Missile build with a Seeker as well as the fact that she's got that Mirror Ball. So that's going to do extra two more magic missiles coming out. Glass Cannon is going to make sure that she does enough damage. And on the side here for Hothead Gaming, looks like it's going to be Stone Form in to let them wither. Very different build, really, for this Lunara. Tempest Fury, it is an inoculation. Undecided for the Zagara, probably going to be the Brute expansion. Yes, it is. Andrew Baby, a lot of trouble there, getting walled back in here. And there goes the Sundering. Nice save, but is it enough? Illidan, all of a sudden, in a lot of trouble. There goes the Steamed Up Thrall. A lot of damage onto Illidan. Illidan cannot afford to take this fight. He's going to do a lot of work, but we definitely need Freedom to reallocate the heal, and he finally does it just nicely. And we see TNK taking a lot of damage, soaking up the backline to distraction there. Nice stun onto Johanna, and it's a kill. Enju Baby now giving the chase. Fantastic fight there by Hothead Gaming. The Steam Drone Thrall did so much work. I don't think that a Playtank could have done anything in that instance. It's like you have Illidan having to run away because of a Steam Drone Thrall. At least that's going to work for a little bit. Lack of a stun, actually, on the side here for Play 10 to take down the Thrall. So that's why the Blizzard Shield was used a little bit too early. You still see some pretty good damage coming out on the side here for the... for Li Ming. Speaking about damage, maybe this is going to help you guys a little bit. Li Ming, 45,000 damage. Very, very impressive level of play here coming from the Magic Missiles build. Normally, you see North America going for a very different style of Li Ming. It's normally going to be the teleport build, as well as maybe the Arcane Up. I like the Arcane Up a little bit better, because Arcane Up, at least you see, you get to do some consistent burst damage from the far line. I'm okay, but at least they got Triumvirate here, which is going to reduce the cooldown, so you're going to expect a lot of Arcane Ups coming out. And now you have also got a Banelings going up. Monokatar taking a lot of damage. Yamato, though, getting healed back up. He's going to be okay. He's going to have to tank through this Disintegrate. Also, the Blazers are coming out, and all of the skills on the red team already being used. You're having the pullback. Nice Ancestral Dust connect beautifully. Andrew Baby still alive. Alinex spots it out the backline, getting consumed by the Devouring Maw. And all of a sudden, Hothead having the pullback. Three men still alive on this side. Two men down already. Alinex still giving a chase. Steam Drone on his Zagara. What a change there. Thrall, unfortunately, not able to hold the front against the Illidan. It's going both ways, at least, this fight. And it's interesting to see that, at least. We are now going to pull back out the Talon Tap to talk a little bit about let them wither. Crippling Spores having some extra slow. It looks like it's a utility Lunara. I don't like this. She does not have the optimal build, I feel. You go into Splintered Spear for range, and then you it's in multiple target, which Noxious Blossom can't provide. And then after that, you have the Unfair Advantage, which does give a bit of extra damage. So you're doing a lot of damage to three different targets at the same time, post Noxious Blossom. And you also let them get revealed. But let them wither. Let them wither. Your Crippling Spores slow. Okay, it's going to be utility-based. At least you have a bit of crowd control. Not really convinced, though. I normally like a full-on damage to Lunara. But here it seems like they really just want to let Thrall do the damage and let Lunara do the crowd control to allow Thrall to catch up to whichever targets that they're trying to chase here. The posturing is going on right now. Monogatari as well, Kicharak trying to channel it one up. Nice Pharaoh Spirit being used. Banelings Burst coming out. There's a lot of sustain on the blue team. So far, like to pull out a sustain tap. And you guys can see that Rengar 60 up against the combined 90,000 sustain on the side of Play 10. Still gonna have that Thrall keep himself alive. Nice Feral Spirit, but that Arcane Up doing a lot of work. Sundering going down as well. Linex going in to pick up this fight right now. And here comes the Illidan. Is it gonna be enough? TNK popping Avatar to hold on the front line. And there goes the Divine Will onto the Illidan, but he wanna try and kill somebody. Ancestral keeps Foshe alive, but Kicharak taking too much damage. And it's gonna be a kill. Nice job there by the Lunara. Yamato giving the chase to the back line. And Thrall still going to close the gap. Tassadar still has got a presence. He's going to be okay for now. No, unfortunately, he will go down. And Illidan goes down as well. 2 to 3 men down on the set of Play 10. That has been a presence there. Very unfortunate, but he does not have the dip shift, that increased duration on dimensional shift. It's very, very important. At level 7, he went for Kalos Embrace instead. And he is not doing enough shielding. If you look at the shielding, it's... Okay, it's 49, it's a lot, but it's not doing enough to keep the entire team alive. I have not seen the entire team with enough shield going to this fight here. So we have a pause. Finally, I need a little bit of a breather as well. Okay, so inoculation here, your initial damage reduction is going to get increased. That really helps. Remember that it also helps to safeguard a target, which normally will be the Thrall. All Lunara. Lunara is very, very squishy. On this side, though, you have also got a trauma trigger, which allows her to have a safeguard when she's down to 50% HP. That is the main reason why Illidan's having a bit of a difficulty against this Morales. I kind of prefer him going for Blood instead on Illidan, because I think that's at least going to be able to do some form of damage. Going for Stone Skin, yeah, well, it's okay. It's not fantastic, but it's fine. On the side of a Lightning Show build, nothing to really complain about. You have the most consistent Rhaegar build here. Would be considering a bit of a heal, maybe. Yeah, but we decided to go for Rising Storm instead. So Rising Storm, at least you have an increased damage, and you have Illidan in the backline, so this makes sense for sure. Also, you have the Earth Shield that basically acts as an extra sponge. Okay, so far, the only interesting thing about the Talon build really is just that Lunara. TNK, gotta be very careful. It's still very tanky, not gonna be easy for just simply the Disintegrate to take him down. And you see the second wind kicking in there. Very, very useful trait for Muradin. And it's not enough to take down the fort. They've been at this for the longest time. Muradin going to close in the gap here. Maybe a little bit too early because the Altas are not spawning yet. And the Bell Tower going down on the bottom right. So 24 against 16. That's the current score. 7 kills against 6. Very, very close series here. Very amazing. Now Play 10 needs to get level 20. They are slowly losing team fights because you see Illidan coming in always a little bit too slow. And the backline getting distracted by Muradin. There is just a lack of support for the front line somehow. Illidan cannot really go in the whole time. And even if it does go in, a great devouring maul by the Zagara Enju baby. That is really a bit of a problem here for the Illidan. And we are seeing the Storm Talon, so we're going to go through them. It's going to be the Hardened Shield as well as Board of the Storm. And look what it is. Galloping Gate. We just talked about this before the stream began. Galloping Gate is so good. It allows Lunara the mobility that she does not have when you are using Thornwood Vine. And I, for the longest time, advocated this pickup at level 20. But nobody seemed to listen to me anyway. Nexus Blade's getting picked up here. A lot of increased damage. I kind of like Sundering AoE all the way across the world. But, That's a fun build. Nexus Blade instead, very important, especially with the Steam Drone. This is going to be exciting. Caduceus Reactor, the only one and only pickup here at level 24 Morales. Meanwhile, on the side for Play 10 Lose 11, we do have Rewind, so that's probably going to mean 2 Lightning Shield, as well as a bit of increased heal, as well as also the Demonic Form, so that will help with the increased attack speed on the side here for Illidan. You also get to see the Indestructible Rewind and also Temporal Flux. Rewind also on Tassadar, so they're really looking for sustain here on Play 10. Trading the towers and getting the altars going out is a bit of extra advantage for the red team. They managed to reclaim the bottom right, so it's 19 against 13. And TNK pulling back, Zagara already channeling this one, I should be able to get it. Meanwhile, the fight going on, Ailes. And a lot of trouble, Disintegrate needs to relocate, there we go, perfectly done. Coupe still doing a lot of work in the background, nobody seemed to care about Coupe, and that's a big mistake. TNK pulling back the stun, does not connect, coming up from the Muradin. Arcane up, going up, a nice block there by the minions, not like they wanted to anyway. TNK gonna be okay, Andrew baby as well, but 2 versus 5, that's a pretty good fight. We're gonna see if we actually have a replay for that one. Coupe doing whatever he can, another Disintegrate, it's not very effective against Muradin. You see those extra magic missiles coming out, as well as the Arcane up. Definitely this is going down. Halas Horseman is back. We are now going into the replay while blue team's getting a bit of respawn bandwidth here. So what happened in the last fight is you could see that they are already very, very low. Lunara getting bursted down. It seems like the red team figured out where's the mistake. As long as that actually is a really bad fight for the blue team to take. They are so split up. They cannot afford to be so split up. They are split in 3 different directions. Lunara going back up, and you have like Thrall going to the left, Morales as well, and then you have the rest of them going down to the bottom. We do apologize for the lag there in the replay. Seems like we have to reset the stream. There is also a bit of a change in the possession of the Bell Tower. The mid left is being picked up by Play 10. And we also got a reclamation here by Hothead Gaming on the top left. So 4 more damage to the core by Play 10 by the Hitless Horseman. 14 against 10. 2 Altas spawning. It's not going to be game yet, but they're slowly starting to trade the Bell Towers. Play 10 looking really good. Hothead Gaming is still not out yet. Six now. It's going to be five against three. And that's where you're going to be very, very careful, because if they do able to pick up both sides, you will be left with just a measly 4 HP, and that's really, really, really dangerous to be in. Nice defensive by TNK. Shugler not connecting to the back line. Coupe up with the disintegrate. 20 seconds cooldown. Very useful. Now they want to pick this fight. That is all that Thornwood Vine going out. Not very effective connecting. Only one charge on that Johanna. Monogatari looking for the Psionic Storm. But the Shugler is going to go out first. They're staggering this really well coming up from Play 10. Linex knocking on that tower instead. Freedom getting cancelled by right click from the Tassadar. Linex with the Metamorphosis going in. Porsche pulling back out. Nice force on to split the fight. Good try at least. And Monogatari having to pull back out. TNK, oh nice, disintegrate there by TNK, landing the stun. Sundering not being very effective. There goes the Ferrous Spirit. Yamato needs to go in. Where's the Steam Drone? This is going to be the time. Steam Drone does connect, but no more lockdown. You also see in the background there, it's a two-man devouring maw, and it looks like Tassadar does still have got a Prescience. Will be able to pull back. There goes the Prescience, and he gets chased out of this entire fight. A bit of a mistake by Yamato to chase down the Tassadar. Porsche will be able to kickstart the ancestral healing, and it goes down beautifully. The fight still continues on. TNK stuns minions, not the best play there. Not sure if Johanna had the indestructible of cooldown. I did not see it proc. The Ancestral was so beautifully timed coming out of their Rhaegar. They will be able to get this altar. And all just because they want to have the advantage. 9 versus 7, the closest House of Doom game you will ever see. And looks like it's a successful reclamation on the top left bell tower. Again, Meat Laugh, it's going to Play 10 once again, and this is where the pressure is continuing to mount on against Hothead Gaming. They are having to just trade towers and bow towers, by that I mean. Looking for some assistance of these pumpkin heads. Nice false wall, but they don't have Steam Drone for 20 seconds. Gotta be very careful. TNK goes in for the stun. No Ancestral for 20 seconds. Red Team doesn't want to fight as well. And they pulled back out from both sides. It's a free mercenary camp here for the blue team. Probably going to be able to plow down the bottom lane here, but I don't think it's going to do much of a damage to the bell tower regardless. So we're going to see the meat fort going back to the blue team's possession. But red team already with a top lane offense. Maybe they can come in here to stop this this chain tower trading, but nope. Illidan is doing a lot of work. And the shield fully casted onto Illidan. Monogatari just very, very much obsessed with keeping Illidan alive, and that's very important, but he's going to have to shield everyone else, and you're looking at him shielding the Kicharak as well as the Porsche, and that would be the Johanna as well as Rhaegar. Hold that thought. We're having a flank. Monogatari with the Psionic Storm. Nice false wall. Is it able to split the fight? We're seeing Monogatari taking a lot of damage, also popping the dimensional shift. Already Andrew Baby in a lot of trouble. Linex with the Metamorphosis and a fantastic pickup there by the Tesla. Lunara does go down, and also going to see the Ancestral. A bit unnecessary, but the damage has been done, and it seems like Hothead's in a lot of trouble. TNK now pulling back out. It's two altars. This could be game, and it looks like TNK is the sole survivor here of the blue team. Four men down on the side of Hothead Gaming and Play 10. They really need to win this year. They just need to pick up both altars, and it's going to be game. One solo Muradin. Is it going to be enough to buy enough time? We already have Rhaegar in the bottom sight. TNK getting slowed by Temporal Flux. Jumps off to a separate direction. If we don't stop this, it's over. And I think it's over. There we go, ladies and gentlemen. After a close series, the last fight of all, Play 10 will win this game. Impossible game to cast. This is as crazy as it gets. The first game of the Thailand Nationals, and Play 10 winning themselves the first one. What an awesome series. Very good play there by Tassadar, of course, MVP style. Fantastic force wall, and he just split the fight in so many different directions. Like, they were all choked up and on top, but they don't have the angle for Thrall to go in. Let's look at a replay and see what exactly Thrall was doing. The Steam Drone, there's too many things happening in that fight. And if you realize here, Morales does have the Steam Drone. Thrall was trying to pull back out. TNK already very far in front. And this Sundering did a little effect, because the backline is the one doing the damage. You realize that Tesla is doing a lot of work in the site, and there goes he steam drones the Muradin instead of Thrall, because Thrall died there. That's a lot of burst from Coupe. Coupe did so much work in this game. 26 minutes, 123,000 damage. That's the main reason why he's been bursting down a lot of targets. 4 kills directly to Coupe. It has to be the Leeming. Thundering should have connected on the backline. At least that's going to help stop a little bit of damage there. Okay, seems like we are actually lagging very badly, so we're going to restart the stream. And hope you guys enjoy the cast regardless. We'll be back shortly, so sit tight, stay tuned.
But the blink away, but Jaina is in the background doing lots of damage, but he's gonna have to back off here. Blue team looks like they're in control of this game, as we see Kiltas finally gonna fall, Falstaff gonna follow suit as well, and things are not looking good for the red team. The blue team is picking them off right here. Malfurion dropping really, really low and finally gonna get taken down, at least with his clone. Not gonna be able to do much there. I don't think he's gonna be able to take down that Uther, as he's gonna probably gonna go and channel Andrew Baby, gonna dwarf toss out to safety, but that's gonna be it. And the blue team will be able to pick up the curse, and right now they're gonna push down this middle lane.